I'm Christopher Neugebauer. I was twice organiser of PyCon Australia while it was in Hobart, and I'm now a committee member for Linux Australia, which is the organisation which, amongst other things, underwrites this conference, PyCon Australia itself. And you know, I'm keen about people being able to meet each other and learn from each other, and that's why I do this.
Hi, my name is Stefan. I'm a software developer for a consulting company in Sydney. My community is basically my workmates of about three or four or so, and I just wanted to see if I can get anything out of this in terms of leadership. Yeah.
Hello, my name is Mark Atwood, and I'm the Director of Open Source Engagement at Hewlett-Packard, and among many other things that I do, one of the more fun parts of my job is I get to sign the check that causes that big blue ball in the upper left of that sign. I've gone to Jono's CLS at OSCON for about 4 years now, and so I was pretty excited to see that it's starting to spread around the world, and I'm also very excited to see that the skill of community management is spreading out from just open source software development to other projects and communities and ways that groups of people who make things can interface to the groups of people who are excited about the things that they do.
My name's David Bell. I'm conference director of LCA 2016, which I hope you'll all be at.
Where is it?
Geelong.
Where is that?
Next to Melbourne.
Melbourne adjacent.
It's not quite Melbourne.
It's a suburb of Melbourne. I'm here because I think this community is awesome, and I want to see what more I can do to give back to this community, which is why we're running LCA.
Hi. Andrew Tridgell. So I'm the project leader for Autopilot. Open source autopilot, and also was one of the founders of the Samba project.
I'm Adam Thomas, I'm from Canberra, and I'm one of the unlucky individuals who's involved in the organisation of the hackerspace there, and it presents leadership problems.
Opportunities.
Yeah. Problems are opportunities. They're also problems.
Hey, I'm a bit late, so I'm not quite sure what I should be saying. I am Audrey Lobo-Pulo. I have been a policy analyst for many years. I work for government, and you'll be seeing me passionately pushing for getting our government models publicly released and open source. So, yeah. I used to work for the Department of Treasury.
No, which country?
Australia, sorry.
Okay,
yeah, but we are actually in the process of having a collaboration with the New Zealand government too, so it's going to be, a Australian-New Zealand venture. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Sue. I'm actually on the fringes here. I'm a nurse educator who's coming to perhaps explore what you've got on offer in terms of end usability, particularly with students and in my teaching capacity. And I also happen to be mother of Kathy.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. I'm Kathy Reid. I'm Kathy Reid. I'm David's 2IC for LCA 2016 in Geelong. It's just an hour away from Melbourne. Fantastic beaches. We'll catch up later. In the past, I've run bar camps. I've been on core teams for LCA in the past. In my day job, I'm a delivery manager, and I run a community of around 400 content developers and content authors. And Geelong is a regional town. I'm trying to grow the open source community and nurture that open source community in Geelong. And I'm looking for tips and tricks, and hopefully I can contribute something back as well today. And thank you, Donna. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Maya Soren. I'm co-chair of the board of the Open Knowledge Foundation, which in Australia, well, okay, it's a global not-for-profit that does what it says on the tin, which is opening up information and knowledge and data. A lot of open government stuff in Australia, it's heavily involved with running GovHack. I personally run a weekend hackathon for medical research problems, so a bit like GovHack, but for medical research, which started in Melbourne the year before, and I think this year is going to be in about four or five different cities in Australia. And I do a lot of community management in and around sort of health and government and research and science. And my day job, I do the people end of software consultancy for small delivery teams.
Hi, I'm Michael Howden. I'm the CEO of the Sahana Software Foundation. We do open source disaster management software for humanitarian organizations and disaster management agencies. I'm based in Auckland, and I'm really interested in like looking at our community engagement. Especially, we've got a very diverse community with sort of developers, designers, documenters, as is normal, but also trying to engage with people who are working in disaster management agencies and humanitarian organisations, very different cultures, looking around the world in different countries and how to pull that all together.
Hello, my name is Clinton. I'm from Brisbane. I'm involved in a lot of open source based communities around Brisbane. I've helped run a lot of meetups, a lot of conferences, and I find myself sort of accidentally in a go-between position between a lot of different communities in the South East Queensland region.
Yep. You did.
Hi, I'm Brenda. I am a programmer, I guess. I have a leadership role at work. I'm also involved in governance layers of a couple organisations. One is Internet NZ, which is one of our sponsors, and the other one is a director of NZ Registry Service, which runs the .nz domain name. And I love open source.
Hi, I'm Oren. I'm I don't know what I do. I type for a living, to steal Brenda's words. I'm here because I said I would run Pilates Wellington, and I would like to know how to actually do that.
My name's Deb Nicholson. I have like a similar problem as you do, where I always say yes to the things or volunteer myself for the time I don't have. I'm the Director of Community Outreach at the Open Invention Network. I sit on the board at Open Hatch, which is also known as Free Software's Welcoming Committee, or at least that's what we like to call it. I help with the Boston Python Meetup, which is the largest Python meetup in the world. And I also am the community manager for Media Goblin, which is a decentralized media hosting project and a GNU project.
Hi, I'm Carol Smith. I run the Google Summer of Code program, which is a large-ish community all over the world that I somewhat manage some of the time. And I am a newly indoctrinated New Zealand holiday person, so if anyone wants to see my photos of the South Island, I would be happy to share them.
Hi, I'm Leslie Hawthorne. I'm the Director of Developer Relations at Elasticsearch. We have a large global community, have been doing the community thing for a while now. Very excited to share knowledge and learn from all of you lovely humans.
Hi, my name is Daryl Berkey. I'm from Australia, and today I'm wearing my Computing Assistant Support and Education hat. We're known as CASE, and we're an organization that likes to think we're making the world a better place one Linux box at a time. And the way we do that is by helping other nonprofit organizations. So we're a specific service for the nonprofit sector. I'm here today because I'm really quite concerned about the state of health of the nonprofit sector, because we're getting a lot of feedback that politics is really squashing the type of ideas and energy that we're hearing about in this room. And I think it's in a very, very serious situation right now. And we need people to come forward and start putting some positive energy into that, because the third sector really is under attack, and we've got a lot of problems, and I think it's really quite serious.
Very small.
Hi, I'm Graham Gillatley. During the day, I run IT for a company called Roofing Industries in Auckland. And as part of that, we run an open source business management system, formerly called OpenERP, but now Odoo. And I sit on the board of the Swiss nonprofit that looks after all the community code under AGPL. And we're fairly fledgling, but we've got a massive user base worldwide, so I'm hopefully going to take some stuff out of this today that we can take back to the board.
Hi, I'm Byron. I'm a full-time Bugzilla dev at Mozilla, and I'm interested in what better to improve our engagement with our community.
Hi, I'm Suz Oliver. As well as working full-time as a DBA, I'm also director of Diamond Age. So we not only make 3D printers, we also run the Diamond Age Fab Lab, which is an open workshop with some pretty tools in it that people can come along and use for free.
Hi, I'm Mark. I'm currently involved with my local user group as treasurer, which is Humbug. We're a Unix user group, not a Linux user group. I've been involved in the open source community probably since about 2002, actually, when I started with Humbug. And then years later, I got started getting roped into these conference things, you know, like with OSDC. I started doing OSDC 2007, started doing some kind of organizational thing. Then we did LCA 2011. Then I did, you know, be involved in the recent PyCon AU. So, basically, I'd like to see what other, you know, what other ideas people have, and, you know, maybe I could share some information about, you know, just my involvement in conferences and stuff. So.
Hello, my name's Andrew Bartlett. I'm a long-time member of the Samba team, not as long as some, and I'm interested in sort of models of leadership through mentorship, as I've been greatly appreciated as others have mentored me. Well, I'm also on the admin committee for the Samba team, and that occasionally tries to get used as a leadership body, even though we try not to be. So I'm trying to understand sort of roles of leadership in like the collaborative community that Evan was talking about this morning.
My name is Paul. I'm from Perth. I was on the organising team for LCA last year. I do some stuff for Plug, Treasury, and other open source software advocacy stuff in Perth, or free software and Linux stuff as well. Run my own business, been doing it for about 8 years, so do lots of open source solutions and sometimes, unfortunately, proprietary stuff, but as much open source and Linux as I can, and do some free networking things in Perth too, events and trying to people together and share open source and promote it a bit, so yeah.
So a huge collective welcome to all of you. I'm now even more excited about the kind of, like, what's that word, the kind of gravitas of what we've got in the room now, I think. Unconferences are run by the principle of the people who need to be there are there, and I feel really, really optimistic about what we're going to see happen throughout the day, which is what we should move on to. We all briefly introduced ourselves and sort of gave a bit of background, but what I really want to focus on now is do a quick bit of brainstorming on what do we want to talk about today. I'm going to let this be led a little bit by some of the people who have been at CLS in Portland. I've gone through the community forum and teased out some of the common issues and put them on the wiki. There's things like burnout, there's things like events, there's a whole range of things that usually get spoken about, but they may or may not be the things that we want to talk about today. So framing the kinds of things that matter, you know, we're part of CLS globally, but this is about our day and what we need to share and what we need to learn from each other. So I want to I'm going to look at Leslie to have a quick word about that. And I also know that Maya has something that she would like to talk about today. So I also want to put that in the mix, that I'm really open to the idea of whether or not we break into group discussions or we have sort of more traditional sage on the stage, people talking up the front and giving sessions. So I actually want to negotiate that with all of you, and we might end up having a mix of both, some lightning talks, some longer pieces, and some group discussions. Does that sort of feel right? Anyone want to stage a revolution just yet? No? Okay. I'm going to... Yeah? Excellent. All right. So I'm going to... So far. Yeah. Keep me on my toes. I'm going to hand to Leslie and then Carol. And you've been to CLS?
Yeah.
Who else has been to CLS in Portland? Mark and... All right. So I'd like to have a quick snippet from each of you who've been to CLS to sort of set the scene and perhaps start to surface some of the things we want to talk about. And I will madly scribe on the whiteboard.
So for those of you in the audience who are with the unconference format, one of the things that's really cool about it is we, the audience members, create the agenda here for today. So instead of it being a series of lectures which may or may not be applicable to our needs and interests, they're clearly applicable to our needs and interests because we can articulate what those needs and interests are and help each other work on it. I've attended the Community Leadership Summit, I guess, since its inception, and I've seen topics discussed from how do I find funding for my free software project to community manager group therapy, which is always a popular topic, to what is the best process to organize my documentation to make sure that my users are able to use it effectively, to what is the best way to go about hiring a full-time person for our open source project when before we've had no further paid contributors. So honestly, the conversations here can run the gamut. It's whatever's most useful to us. So, and don't be afraid to like bring your group therapy problems. None of us will tell, we promise.
Except for the live stream. They won't tell either. They're very nice people.
So typically at CLS, they do breakout rooms with multiple sessions. So it sounds like it might make more sense since we're a smaller group to just do one session, but I think it's up to you. The other thing I was going to add to the list of topics that I see a lot is metrics, from the sense of how do I gauge whether my community likes me and likes my project and thinks I'm doing a good job versus also like metrics around how the project, how do you know how healthy the project is? So that was something I was going to add. And yeah.
We totally like you.
Yeah. How do I know?
I just told you. All right. Some of the other sessions that I've seen are where small projects that have a problem that comes up once and they don't necessarily have someone who's tasked with that, so like an issue might be trademark, like, oh, we're going to have to deal with this once. We'd like to ask the larger community so that we don't have to go in totally blind on this process. And I've seen that with what do we do with the super curmudgeonly person that makes everyone else want to leave, or any range of problems where you're like, I know someone else has done this. I'd just like to hear what other people did. So, yeah, so those are other topics that we could talk about. Where am I? Is this going to Mark? Okay. Yes.
So. I'm sorry, what am I doing? All right. One of the things that has worked well for me at CLS and I've seen work well is, as some others have pointed out, the take the best practices and also actually the worst practices. Many projects have deep dysfunctions that they're not able to root out of themselves, but they're able to warn others about.
Is marketing part of this stuff here as well? Is it part of the agenda? Cool.
So I know you said there was something I wanted to talk about. I don't actually remember. Like, I know we had a very drunk discussion about it a couple of times. Maybe. So there are things I want to talk about, and one of them is sustainable handovers. Do you remember the thing I wanted to talk about?
No.
Okay.
Thanks, Maya. Just bouncing off what Maya said about sustainable handover, I'd like to have a discussion about sustainable pipeline activities. So bringing junior people through the community as people need to go off and do other things or reach burnout. So making sure that you have a good pipeline.
Just going through random notes here. So we've got funding, retention and recruitment. Have we got a burnout line? Like that's kind of all burnout, retention, recruitment. Diversity, the sort of the right, correct aspect versus the important aspect of it.
Diversity being
the correct thing to do versus diversity being the important thing to do. And just overall management, I suppose.
Problem people and how to handle them across communities, especially.
Maybe processes for creating engagement, people that you already have, but that you like to develop into leadership positions. Or just, you know, getting them to hack on stuff.
Oh, yeah, possibly.
What was that again?
Succession planning.
Yeah, so kind of sustainable handling stuff as well.
Managing conflict.
Oh, no,
sorry.
You'll have words about that, Christopher. Sorry.
I won't stand for interruption like that, really.
Dealing with disengagement.
Governance. Yep.
Is that linked to politics?
Yep.
Ideally, yes.
Yep. Fundraising.
Where is that?
Funding and raising, not necessarily the same thing. Yep.
I thought for me, this is a bit about, I suppose, the life cycle of communities. Go from a small project to a larger project, and
growth.
All of a sudden, we're not dealing with just developers anymore.
Yep.
You've got to deal with a lot more different things.
As well as funding budgeting.
Budgeting. Yep.
I would actually like.
Let's have a massive heading that says money.
Yeah.
I would like to see a kind of a side bullet of life cycle and growth. Like, how do you wind down a community? Because there are some communities where it's time for them to wind down, and how do you do that process?
Oh, the tick mission accomplished.
Oh, nice.
Beautiful.
Why?
It's in my talk tomorrow.
we'll come to your tomorrow. It's a plug.
Yeah.
Maintaining context appropriate tone.
Context appropriate tone. I think you might need to unpack that a little bit.
We need context.
So, when it's right to be making jokes about things?
Know thine audience.
Culture. Yeah. Treat.
Protecting your community from having to think about all the things on the board. Isn't that what we get? Exactly. It's also, you know, project leaders as umbrellas is the way I like to think about it.
Someone said culture. Did that make it up there?
Sorry?
Culture.
I think that one's like...
that's a white nail, I'm not sure.
What Trish said, I think, is really kind of key, protecting your community from this stuff. And I want to preach a little bit here, is that there are people in our community who do a lot of this stuff. And it's generally not as visible and as valued as the code, as the stuff that people can see and the stuff that people can touch. And I think it's one of the reasons why the series of conversations going on is really important, that protecting our communities from all of this stuff is key to what we're talking about and why we're here, and making sure that it doesn't hurt us who are involved in it. Because this one is comes up time and time and time again. Sorry, it says burnout. Yeah, burnout. And the retention and recruitment, but we're seeing people cycle in and out of the communities because this work is, it's not easy work. And in some places it's not valued work, but there are some of us who love doing it anyway. And I don't know if we're gluttons for punishment or just rainbows of light and optimism and unicorns, but yeah, key. Thank you.
That's one of the big issues that I have in my voice, that the point of the metrics and one of the advice that I have there, that all the metrics for recognising contributors, to recognise all that stuff, is all very much code-centric. It's very much who made the pull request, you know, who did this, who did that. It's how do we recognise contributors for their contribution. Actually, I know Mozilla's people is quite important for that as well. Hopefully in a fairly automated way. I mean, in terms of recognising who's contributed so that it's fair, it's not, you've got thousands of contributors.
Yeah, it's a tough one.
I know, just to add on that, like, not just recognising your non-coding contributors, but making sure that they feel like they're part of your governance and everything, so it's not like, oh, well, you can do like 70 hours of graphic design for us, but like you can't be on the board because you haven't contributed any code. That person's probably not going to do that again.
Well, and jumping on that, what kind of recognition? Is it monetary or non-monetary?
And how? Yeah.
I'm sorry, the layperson. What's the question that's being put
forward? Oh, sorry, and we'll get an intro from you too. We're doing an unconference, so we're brainstorming now the kinds of things that we want to talk about, and CLS is part of the global kind of network, I guess, now, of these conversations, and there are a few people in the room who've been to them, so we sort of seeded the conversation that way, and now we're just kind of brainstorming what do we want to talk about today in the context of community leadership, community management. And thank you, Evan, for non-hierarchical collaboration, which I think is something that's...
Mm-hmm.
Yes, please.
We sort of got burnout. We don't really have physical health, mental health.
Ooh.
There's a
kind of part of that
thing.
Health and well-being, mm-hmm. and healthy communities.
2 a.m. is definitely the right time to be replying to emails on my list.
And I don't know how to word this, but a lot of these communities, there are professional things that we're doing, there are projects that we're doing, but there are also friendships, and there are certain points in times where we need to switch this up, and I don't really...
Yeah, that's actually really interesting to me too, because there's this sort of public and private sphere stuff that kind of comes into the open source community world as well. We work in stuff, some of us work on stuff for our day jobs, and some of us work on stuff in our own time, and we build these friendships and relationships that sort of span across it, and sometimes the line between professional and personal can, and that causes other kinds of interesting problems sometimes, code of conduct violations. Anyway, I won't go down that rabbit hole just yet. Interesting. I don't know how to put it either. Any other thoughts? Yeah?
Another thought on that, but for your topics of discussion, you had two people mentioned dealing with problem people and resolving conflict and stuff.
Yep.
And I think personally, it's actually more helpful to discuss how do we communicate and what do we do well, and focus on what you actually do. Because if you do those things, in my opinion and my experience, is that you tend to minimize the conflict stuff.
But 6 years later, they're still doing it, same problem too. So you've got both going.
Yeah.
I would be interested.
Excuse me. But you're saying 6 years later, people come into this community at different points in time, and you come into a community and you don't know how that community communicates them what their skill and what their viewpoint is on how you do these things, and it's very, it's a different culture.
There are different...
How do I know how to communicate in this culture if there's no way for me to learn how to communicate in this culture?
I think you
touch on, I think you touched on a very good point, and I think that's induction processes and introduction to community. Would that be a fair summary on?
That's part of it, yes, being included in that whole.
I view problem people as usually people who've been there a very long time.
Well, I've had a case of a member of our team who, in front of all of us, was always absolutely behaved in an appropriate manner, but it turned out then, when no longer in our presence, was behaving in an inappropriate manner, and we had to deal with this. And sometimes, you know, you can be with a person all the time, and you don't know about it until you hear from someone else that they're behaving inappropriately.
So with this kind of bubbled up into conversation, so I think this is one we want to put on the table, definitely, at some stage today, whether or not it's, right. Well, let me get another colour. And there's this, elements to it. So there's this dealing with problem people across communities. There's the positive, reinforcing positive communication patterns, and how we do inductions and, there was something in what you said that I didn't quite capture there. Your interactions with someone are familiar and they're always fine, and it's the interactions you don't see that are problematic. Yeah. So it's kind of,
poisonous people.
Yeah.
Can we please not say people are poisonous?
Sorry?
Can we please not say that people are poisonous?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm referring to a really well-known talk, but it was given by a couple of software developers, so that's where I'm getting the phrase from.
It's a
respond, but in this context, in this room, I prefer we didn't call people poisonous.
Would be disruptive. Do you think disruptive would be better?
It's not the person.
No, okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. You're saying just not labeling the person.
An ad hominem attack to say that somebody is poisonous.
Actually, key. Problem behavior.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
I think. Thank you. It's good. It's a good reminder that different people in different contexts and different places behave differently, and there are different rules. And so my behaviour right here without a headscarf is fine. My behaviour with bare arms and no headscarf in some other places would be totally unacceptable. So being aware of the appropriate behaviour, and that was someone else said,
like culture
and tone and appropriate things, and always good to be mindful. One and then here.
Making people feel safe. My theory is that people are problematic when they don't feel safe.
I've got a flip side to that too, is there are people who make our communities not feel safe. So it's all in there. So it's a
vicious cycle.
Complicated. It's good stuff.
I think this has come up in some previous comments, but I really loved your current example about context, and I think creating a truly global community as opposed to paying lip service to global community is difficult and something we should wrangle through together.
Yes, I'm actually guilty of reminding some people in the Drupal community every now and again by saying global. That word, I don't think that word means what you think it means when they schedule meetings at 3 a.m.
An interdisciplinary, not just thinking about a tech community, but if your community has to touch on different sort of disciplines, I've often found it's easy to work with a tech person in Indonesia than it is to work with a sort of Western person in a different sort of domain.
Yeah, and remembering that we're going to learn something from people outside our domains.
Absolutely.
And you have to understand that their behaviour sometimes will be offensive to you.
Yes, and choose to.
And vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Choosing not to be offended, if you have the ability to do so. All right, so dear Irish open source contributor, let's say now apologies to my US friends who said, and try not to be offended when the Americans are being offensive. Okay, it's a good thing to remember. Noren.
I'm offended.
You're offended. Well, we just try not to be when you guys miss. We've got a lot of stuff up here. I think we could probably continue brainstorming for some time, but I suspect we've got enough to cover. In fact, we probably need to try and chunk it down. So the thing that I need to get now is we want to have a few lightning talks. I mean, there's some amazing people in the room with extraordinary experiences. Do we want to have a bit of a round of some lightning talks on key topics? Or do we want to break into some discussions around the bit that interests you the most? or do we want to have a kind of, you know, ongoing group discussion?
You think it's, I'm really impressed that you think someone can extend the lightning talk if you can. Kudos to you. My own experience is I can whip off a 3-hour talk extemporaneously, but it takes me a week to write a lightning talk. The shorter they are, the more they are.
I can do a minute lightning talk right now.
Minute lightning talk from Clinton. We'll get a lightning talk from Mark next year.
Donna, could I perhaps make a suggestion and see if the room agrees? There's a lot of topics on the board. I actually wonder if we should use a process like dot voting or see what and shake out the ones that we want to spend the most time on because our time will be limited if everyone agrees.
Yeah, I'm up for that. Do you want to kind of filter it down a little? Thumbs up over there. Yeah?
I could use, at the risk of being called dumb, I could use a more global explanation of what it is we want to accomplish. Because there's a lot of topics there, but you know, just throwing out topics doesn't really get you to a destination.
So
are we trying to get to a destination, or are we just having discussions about things so that we can share, you know, experiences and learn from each other? That's valuable as well. But I just, you know, I look at that and I'm a little confused.
Good, really good question. I don't have a fixed
desire
for an outcome
for
today. But if we, you know, if something is burning to say, yeah, we can do something, then that's totally put on the table. It's open.
I mean, having not been to an conference, you know, I'm new to this. So, yeah, where are we going? And I'm happy just to wander as well.
Yep.
On that, it seems like the conversations that are the most productive at CLS is when it's a mix of people who, I really need to know this is super timely for me right now, and some folks who are able to say, I have something to add, I have some experience on that particular topic. Because the conversations where everyone already knows it, it's like, yeah, nope, you're awesome, that's the way to do it. And the ones where nobody has dealt with it before tend to be like, so I feel like the most productive conversations are where you have like, you know, like, oh, we dealt with poisonous behavior, and we're dealing with it now and really need to know, or whatever it turns out to be. So if we dotted them, we might want to have people say, like, I need this advice, I have some experience to add.
Yeah, and I just had a thought that maybe we could run around and put some question marks on them, like, I need to know this, and maybe some ticks, well, I know about this, if we run around with whiteboards. So put a question mark next to something that you want to know about, and a tick next to something that you know, you reckon you can share something on, that would be good. So going back to Daryl's point, I think I purposefully did not come into this saying we're going to achieve an X or a Y or a Z. I do know that X and Ys and Zs get created out of sessions like these, so I'm not discounting it's going to happen, but I'm not driving towards that. But if you have something that you know you want to work towards, let's put it up there. But Kathy's idea of dotting with question marks and ticks, yes? I don't know how many of these we've got. I've got 4. So let's do a bit of milling. While this happens, feel free to talk to each other and share, you know, thoughts, and let's just have a little bit of a get up and move around and be active. So come get up.
So the process is, if you can talk about something, you put a dot next to it, if you're interested in hearing about something, you put a question about it.
Almost. Tick for I know something about this and can share. Question mark for I want to know something about this.
Okay.
Yeah? Tick for yes, I know something. Question mark for tell me.
Doesn't matter what color.
Doesn't matter. Oh, you got more pens.
Got more pens.
More pens.
More pens.
Make sure that they're white pens. Make sure they're white.
I don't have my glasses on.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, it's fine.
I left. I said, please don't talk to the person. And you did it quickly. Kind of like.
but I could be totally wrong, but that's what it felt like. He's left his stuff. Oh no, that's someone else. I
Thank you. around some key topics.
I actually remember this in the noise training about 2 years ago.
Thanks, Maya. See? Collaborative learning, transfer around knowledge.
Very good. Accommodating and welcoming where we can without necessarily having to go over all the ground that we've covered. So it's just going to be a bit of a balance here. We may have some people come and go. Yes.
Care if I stick you on Twitter?
No. If I cared about that, go for it.
It's kind of our job to be on Twitter.
What?
One of our jobs is to kind of be on
Twitter. Be on Twitter, yeah. We should be sharing what we know as much as we can. If you're comfortable, if you're on the Twitters, or the, is it still called Identica? I don't know. Anyway, please do share this broader conversation. Okay, so let's see what we've got. I'm seeing a real big cluster here around a red pen. Big cluster around protecting your community from this stuff. Yes. Some question marks and some ticks around the budgeting, funding, fundraising, money as Chris suggested. It. Some stuff here around metrics. Big chunk around the burnout, retention and recruitment bit. Ooh, some on diversity. Big one here on problem behavior across communities. Lots of question marks and lots of ticks as well. Cool. It's a bit around creating engagement and leadership development. It's this one. I can't even read my own writing. Managing conflict. Lots of both ends. Looks good. Some questions and some not answering some tips. Yes. Life cycle growth.
Including one down.
Including one down.
Oh, beautiful.
Upside down,
Miss Jane. Upside down. How to recognise all? Yeah, that one looks. And feel part of it. How? And these ticks here. Is this around feeling safe or around how?
That's a feeling safe.
That's a feeling safe. So that's there. There's quite a bit there too. And interdisciplinary, I think. They seem to be the ones that really jump out. We've still got a lot of stuff. So. I'm thinking there's a lot on this one.
I'm surprised how many ticks there are on that one. Is that one including the health quality thing down the bottom?
I think they're related, aren't they?
This is a lot of ticks.
Okay. We have agreement that health and wellbeing and burnout retention are related.
Yeah. And Donna, I think the creating engagement is very much related to burnout. Because if you're not feeling engaged, if you start to become feeling disengaged, you're at a much higher risk of burnout. I think there's a crossover there.
Yes. And also the flip side, you're a bit too engaged.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Not enough balance.
Yes.
Yeah.
And if you're the only one engaged, you are going to burn out.
Sorry, I just had a kind of very visceral.
Also, sorry, I wonder what the self-engagement would look like.
Well, first you get down on one knee in front of the mirror and say, I love love you very much, and I'd like to spend the rest of my life with you.
Alright, so I'm just going to make a bit of a call here, that like the weight of the board. I think burnout, retention, health, well-being, creating engagement, that definitely seems to be a thing. The protecting your community from this stuff, which can end up being a bit of a catch-all for whatever as well, because it's. But I think the protecting bit there is really key. So those two. Then, I think, help me people, is it how to recognise all contributions or life cycle of growth, or is that actually related?
I actually think they're completely different. I'd say one of the rights more related to metrics than the one on the.
I feel like when we spoke about it before, the protecting your community from this stuff and the how to recognize all contributions were like came out as related. We just kind of ran out of space to stick them next to each other.
Yeah.
And so I don't know if that would be like kind of a.
So I think that call is right, that metrics is definitely part of the recognition stuff. I agree with that. And the relationship between protecting your community from this stuff, recognizing is part of it. So yes.
And that's part of the positive communication.
And part of the positive communication patterns bit. Okay. All right, so. We've got some key areas here. Now we've really got to make a decision about how we want to continue. But there's like an echoey spot right here about where we want to continue the way the day works. Do we want to continue to have a big group discussion? Do we want to hear from some people? Because I think there's a few ticks up there, and it would be great to just, you know, get some knowledge and resources down and start scribing some stuff, some capturing some of that knowledge. And then, you know. Do we want to do some smaller breakouts on particular topics? So hands up for breaking these chunks down, or do you want to be involved in all the conversations? Breakout, smaller chunks? It's okay, I think we're going to have a mix. It's not an all or nothing decision here. I just want to get a sense of how we weight it. So not so much with the breakouts. A group discussions?
Yes, please.
Yeah?
Yes.
Some presentations? Yeah? All right. So what we should do is get the volunteers who want to do a short talk about something, a lightning talk or, I don't know, spoken word, poetry, or whatever it is that you want to get up and talk about. We'll get you to just put your names up and we'll work through that and we'll keep them nice and tight. But I'd really like to hear a voice other than mine at the front here. And then I think we'll have these discussions. So we'll inform our group discussions, and then I think we can probably only pick maybe two or three of these for this afternoon. Otherwise, I think we're going to be biting off way more than we can chew. So let's kind of, as we hear from some of these, from the experience of some people in the room, maybe that'll help coalesce what we want to focus on for the afternoon. Does that sound okay? Yeah? Any radical kind of sideways thoughts at this point? Some open to them? Hit me? Speak now for 100 things? I'm done. Okay. So, again, up if you... Oh, I can call it out. So hands up if you want to... If you're going to want to talk on something. Sue? Trish? Name, sorry.
Let's go with
Victoria.
Victoria? Yeah.
Actually, and that reminds me, we were going to do a couple of intros of the people who snuck in late, so start with you.
What am I talking about?
Just your intro, because some people came in a little bit late, so I want to give you the opportunity to introduce yourself and say who you are and where you're from, and there's a couple of others too. So.
Wellington? You know the accent? I'm Wellington. I'm returning to IT after raising my children, who are now 19 and 21 or something. The deck assembly language, which is very large, and I have a more powerful one in my pack. Yeah. Use Debian.
Cool. Thanks, and Victoria. Up. Welcome. And up there, a couple of you came in. Just introductions and.
Hi, I'm Shrivi, coming from Hamilton. So I work with one of the networking monitor companies. New Zealand. It's called MBase, so I'm doing project management there. So I was inspired by the symptoms that this session would teach us, so expose us to empowering the community. So it's just,
cool. Yeah. Well, welcome. Thank you. And
I'm Alan Strickland. I'm here from here in Auckland, and I work for Internet New Zealand as a collaboration community lead and help facilitate NetHui.
Welcome, Ellen. I'm particularly pleased to see you because someone said I needed to see you.
Yes.
I see you now. Very cool. Did anyone else sneak in and didn't do intros? Ha! Yep.
I'm Lana, and this is my daughter, Talia. I lead a team of tech writers at Rackspace at the moment, and I'm also fairly highly involved in the open stack community, the documentation side of things. So it's particularly important.
Welcome. Welcome. And
hi, so I'm Josh, currently the president of Linux Australia, so I have a bit to do with managing this community.
Just a little bit.
Well, I like to think this is very self-organized, but that's not always the case. So I missed the beginning, and I do apologize for that. I was preoccupied.
Managing a community,
probably. there'd be two small requests, if that's okay. Could we, for people who are volunteering to do talks, keep just a topic up on that board and just in very one or two sentences, what did you do for the first half? Was it just this whiteboard discussing what you're going to be doing for the day? Yeah.
Okay, I'll come back to those. Okay, so the first one, yes, let's put a bit of a topic next to the name. That's very sensible. And then we'll do the names and then I'll fill you in on how we got to where we are now. Yeah.
So, Suze.
Basically, I was going to cover my experience and some of these items on the board.
Personal experience.
Yeah.
On some stuff.
A few questions as well.
Yep. Mr. Tridgell.
Community leaders as umbrellas.
Victoria.
Welcome.
Welcoming.
I'm sorry, the name of the lady, you just introduced yourself with the Pacifica or Internet?
Ellen.
Yeah, she probably has useful insights from the Pacifica community about the processes.
Welcoming. Very good. Yep.
Importance of diversity.
Clinton diversity. Yep.
I'd like to speak about changing and funding paradigms.
Changing and funding paradigms?
No, changing the way non-profits
changing
are
funding paradigms.
Yeah, how it's changing.
Yep.
Happy? If everyone's interested, I can do a few minutes on metrics. I believe that's 87%.
Very nice.
And your talk is going to be about how you validated that.
Josh,
it's very quick measurement
validation. I'll do a talk on succession shift.
Josh on succession. Right.
So what have we got? We have, I can't even read it over there. Suze is going to talk some personal experience on the stuff that we've got on the board. Tridge is going to talk about community leaders as umbrellas. Victoria is going to talk a little bit about welcoming and perhaps invite Ellen to have some contributions to that. Very nice. Clinton a bit on diversity and Daryl on funding paradigms. Kathy on metrics and Josh on succession. I think those topics actually do match quite nicely against a lot of our ticks and question marks. Anyone else?
If there's time, I'm willing to give a bit of a war story on problem behaviour.
It was Andrew?
Adam.
Adam, sorry. Adam, war stories on behaviour.
As long as it's a resolution. There was a resolution in it.
Oh, you find out more!
Thank you.
cited code of conduct and that kind of management in succession in terms of burnout and relationships.
Just for clarification, these are lightning talks, yes. Not discussions, is that right?
These are quick lightning talks which will probably, hopefully, inform discussions. Yep. Okay, now...
I think they should probably be limited to some amount
of time.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I don't know if we went to a specific number, but it feels like they could get...
Yeah, which actually goes right into what I want someone to do for me right now, is to look at the schedule and say, when is our break? Let's do 12:20, which is
35 minutes.
So someone now do the maths, the number of names on the board divided by the number of minutes, and then we'll break for lunch.
Just less than five.
Yeah,
4 minutes each.
Perfect. Now, I don't know if our AV people can operate the thingies, because you know, who knows, lightningtimer.net? We could start a lightning timer, or do we just plan to work on that? Yeah, lightning, sweet, okay. So, slightly less than 5 minutes, and I think keeping it lots less than 5 minutes, I'm thinking 3 to 4 in that kind of region max. And I take Mark's point that extemporaneous lightning talks are very challenging, but this is about sharing what we know, not necessarily being rock star presenters. So, please, I'll give you a little moment to step. The only thing I'm wondering is, do we just go in order of as they were called out, or is there a kind of natural...
I'll start.
That works for me.
Hello, my name is Clinton. I'm from Brisbane. I recently sort of had a little bit of a confluence of events.
It's probably worth...
I think that one's working now. So I recently sort of had a confluence of events which has sort of shifted my perspective a little bit on things. A very long time ago, like grade six, it became fairly clear to me that there were certain topics that I was thinking about at primary school that other people weren't thinking about. And these were topics on sexism, on diversity, on things that should matter and things that shouldn't matter. So a lot of these things got wrapped up fairly easily in most of the community groups that I was running. If it's a technology-focused group, then the only thing that matters is how you fit into that group and what you provide to that group. A lot of these things are starting to get codified now in terms of code of conduct and things like that. And like until fairly recently, these things were all, to me, seen as important and the right things to do. Recently, we had the Australian disability advocate, Stella Young, die. I've been fortunate enough to see her speak at a number of conferences. So she really sort of opened my eyes in terms of ability and disability. In Queensland, we had the parents... I'm going to get some of the details wrong here. We had the parents of their child write a retraction to the birth notice in the newspaper. Their child was born a male and has since come out as a female. And the parents wrote a retraction. This thing went viral. The newspaper then went on and did like a whole two-page spread on the story. And the other thing that we had happen is there's a member of my community that actually reached out to me for support on some of these diversity issues. So a lot of this stuff that for a long time I sort of felt as the appropriate way to do things, the right way to do things, all of a sudden switched to being the important way of doing things. So I just wanted to sort of get a vague idea of people that have actually been affected by these things and seen how it helps in your communities. So yeah, that's really just wanted to touch on that this stuff. It's not just the right thing to do, it's like an important thing to do because people's lives really are affected by a lot of this stuff. And it is really about protecting and growing your community, I think. So just wanted to put that out there.
Hi, I'm Saz, and my open source project is a little different to most people's because I actually run an open source workshop. It's officially determined as a fab lab. So we've been running this for about 2 years now, and we've actually got to the point where we're up to six staff. We're now down to four, so we've grown quite big. And one of the things that we decided when we were going to employ people is that we were going to make a decision to employ and involve people who were generally viewed as unemployable by most employers. So we've had some interesting challenges with a number of those people, one of which who I mentioned we discovered was very much like a cat. You know, cats think generally that it's okay to jump on the table as long as you're not looking at them. And we found he was similar. You know, he would behave fine in front of us, but not around us. So we've had to deal with a number of issues of people who have mental health problems and so forth. So we've learned a lot about documenting. I mean, we also have a lot of people who don't know us come in and use the workshop and go away again. So we have to have, clear inductions and making sure of that. So we found a lot of, when it comes to documentation in particular, that what's worked very well for us is basically a how do I form of documentation. So essentially an FAQ. And then we've actually ended up drawing a lot of our documentation in very big letters with very big diagrams because a lot of people who came in couldn't cope with pages and pages and pages and screeds of stuff. So it's perhaps a different community to that which most of the people here deal with because, you know, a lot of you mostly deal with, I imagine, with people who are generally on the whole highly intelligent and highly capable because they wouldn't have got into this community otherwise. So I sort of want to suggest to you that you do need to start thinking about getting people into community that are very, very intelligent, but have been excluded generally, partly because they've done very badly in the school system. And the school system has excluded a lot of people. So we've actually found with a number of people that are coming in that they don't or didn't think that they were intelligent and discovering that they've actually got a lot more skill and a lot more ability than they thought they had. So there is this whole group of people out there who are generally viewed as not usable members of society or useful members of society who are and who need people to have that time and patience to help them become useful members of society. So generally, basically, I'm trying to say that I encourage people to deal with a lot of these awkward problem people and to learn how to deal with them. Certainly with our experience, it's been if somebody is behaving in a manner that isn't good, take them in a room, talk to them, tell them what, you know, send things, tell them what it isn't, make sure it's written down, make sure they understand. If they do it again, bring them in, say, do you remember when we talked about it? Be patient, be very patient. But you've also got to understand that there are some times when you've just simply got to say, stop. This person can't be here anymore. And that's when they start calling one of your customers a word that started with F and ended with T and made them very unhappy. So if you've got any questions, do feel free to come and ask me about them.
Thanks, Suze. Can I get a volunteer to perhaps get this info on our wiki, just the name and the topic? Thanks. All right, of course she is. Tridge. And Victoria, do you want to be ready?
Yeah. Thanks. Hi, everyone. So the idea of project leaders as umbrellas actually came about originally when the Linux Care Oz Labs joined IBM, and we had Hugh Blemmings as our the leader within, or the manager within our group. And we realized that part of his job was to act as an umbrella for the hierarchy of IBM, to keep all of that stuff off the geeks in the team who just wanted to write code and submit patches, etc. And since then, I've found that idea of project leaders as umbrellas to be actually quite useful when I'm thinking about what I need to do within a community that I'm part of, particularly technical communities. And the applicability of this idea does depend upon the community. So there's some communities where discussing all of this stuff up front, on the front page, in the mailing, etc., is great, because the people you are engaging with in some communities are very much always thinking about the social issues. But there's other, many of us are part of highly technical communities where code is king, where the geeks want to get involved in writing patches. And for some people getting involved in that project, if they're lurking in a project and they're just cruising around the mailing list and thinking of getting involved, if there's too much discussion of these types of what I think are very important issues, then they may decide that they'll look elsewhere and they get involved in a different project because they don't want to have to think about all these things. They just want to write code. So anyway, just that concept I find useful to keep in the back of my mind, that one of the roles of a project leader is to know when to keep things off, to act as an umbrella and keep things off the people so that they can enjoy the rain-free environment of a project and just worry about the coding and the fun parts. And to know when, you know, you need to raise these things in the community. And in a lot of technical communities, bearing the brunt of that rain of all the stuff can be the role of the project leader. So it's just a useful paradigm, useful way of thinking about it that I've found useful in many projects, and I thought I might share it for other people to think about.
And Victoria is going to talk about welcoming.
Do I need to use this?
Yes.
Can you hear me well enough?
To recording.
So I have to use this?
Yes. Yes.
Well, if you don't want to record it, you
don't. I don't want to record it. Oh. Thank you.